So, good evening, India. This is Amritanshu Vajpayee. I welcome you all on this all-important platform of Saptarshi India, the combined initiative of about 45 VIPnet clubs under the Vigyan Prasar network of science clubs, which have been working together on one platform as for spreading out the field of citizen science and astronomy pan-India. So, I welcome you all. And as we all can see, the guest of honor, the speaker for the day, Dr. N. Ratnashri, has already arrived on this digital platform on the digital dais. And as we all know, today is an important day as far as the field of astronomy is concerned. And because, in fact, formally speaking, it's the first day of the spring season, which is occurring when the sun has passed the equator from the southern to the northern hemisphere. And the North Pole, you can say, has begun to lean towards the sun again. So I won't spoil the surprise for you, because the speaker for the day shall speak and shall throw much light later on the all important topic. And with these words, I also welcome the two co-hosts for me for the day, Mr. B. Srinivas sir and M. Susatya Rekha ma'am. So now I just would request B. Srinivas sir to kindly take over the reins and welcome the speaker for the day and roll out the instructions for all the people who have joined together as participants to this meet. And over to Srinivas sir. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, sir, and good evening, India. Today we have a special talk on astronomy with Dr. Nandivada Ratnashri ma'am, who is the director of Nehru Planetarium and is one of the most enthusiastic astronomers in India. She works tirelessly for the promotion of astronomy in India, and Dr. Ratnashri ma'am has done her BSc in physics from Usman University and MSc in physics from University of Hyderabad, and she did her PhD in astrophysics from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Pune, and after that she started her career as a postdoctoral fellow from University of Vermont in USA in the year 1992, and she served as a postdoctoral fellow and continued here in India from Bangalore, the Raman Research Institute. And Ratnashri madam has published so many research papers in theoretical astrophysics and radio astronomy and archaeoastronomy also. So she is a co-author and the chief advisor for the NCERT publications also. So she tirelessly worked for the promotion of astronomy in India through so many talks and television media and radio talks also. And she speaks many languages, including the Marathi and Telugu also. And Dr. Ratnashri ma'am has now here with us to present a talk on positional astronomy, a walkthrough. So she is going to walk through all the fields of astronomy for the students and as well as for the teachers. So I request all the teachers and the students also who are in this meet to kindly mute yourself. No noise should be there, and turn off your video also, because it takes a lot of bandwidth also. And if you have any query about the talk, you can chat that in the box. So you can send after the lecture, ma'am will answer the questions. So please be muted yourself and don't turn on your video. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. And I invite you formally for the talk. So we have seen so many talks of you in YouTube, in so many talks. So I request you I request you to take the diaspora. Thank you.
Thank you. Amritanshu, Srinivas ji, and Saptarishi Club for asking me to be here today. And this being the equinox day, it was suggested that perhaps positional astronomy topics would be of interest. And so that is what I am planning to talk about. Now, I don't know, some of you in the present today may already have very good idea about positional astronomy and some of the things I talk. Then you just forgive me and be patient while I go through the very basic beginnings. And some may not. So, in any case, for completeness sake, I would like to start in some way at the very beginning and give some idea about possibilities of positional astronomy observations in some way, some quantitative field that any one of us, all of us who are here, we should. So, this is not, don't read this just as a talk. So, this is not a talk. This is kind of a nudge to all of us to do something, to do a little something, a little measurement related to what is called positional astronomy. That is what today's talk I want to make it. And this positional astronomy, what is it exactly? It's to do with positions of object in the sky as measured from a location on the earth, right? And so positions of objects in the sky here in positional astronomy context, it means that it's like we treat the sky like a football over our heads. One half we see at any one time. And so all objects that we see, we kind of assume that they're all on the surface of this football. So, of course, that is not quite true. I'll just start sharing my screen. Yes. So, that is not quite true. When we have these objects in the sky, they may be at different distances from, in our line of sight direction, they may be at different distances. But we see them as if they are on the upper surface, on the surface of a hemisphere. And we treat that as what it is. And we just look at, on that hemisphere, where are these objects? On that half a football on our head and the other half is not visible. So where are the objects on this? So that is what is positional astronomy. Of course, modern astronomy looks at also the distance along the site, and it also looks at physically what these objects are, trying to measure the radiation that is coming from them, how much radiation, how bright, how is it varying, what is its spectrum, what is its polarization. So many of such physical explorations come into modern astronomy, astrophysics. However, positional astronomy is something which has been there for millennia as astronomy, and aspects of positional astronomy are still of interest to us. So, any day we can see so many aspects of positional astronomy which are going to be of so much of interest. So, I want to take you through a positional astronomy walkthrough. What we see here in the background of this slide is actually from one desktop planetarium. Many of you must be using it a lot, and maybe some of you are not aware of it. So, let me just mention to you. This is an app called Stellarium, and there are many such planetarium possibilities. You can even have a live planetarium app on your phone, wherein like you look at it against the sky, and it actually will show you live what stars are there and so on. So for those of you who have not done such observations of the sky, etc., it's just to tell you that there is a lot of help out there. I'm going to actually go to this Stellarium app. I like it very much, apart from, of course, our own planetarium software. So this will help you a lot. And even if you have used it quite a bit, you'll still find that perhaps there are some newer things we can do with it. So before we actually get started with this positional astronomy aspects, walking through that, which means that we look at objects in the sky where they are and actually quantify where they are, and then also try and see the changes of those objects in the sky. That's what we are going to do. So before we do that, I also want to take you back through history, and I want you to note some mentions of what was there in the sky in different contexts. And maybe you have some mentions which you know yourself, you add to this. And the mentions that I'm going to make to you now are those which become of interest over long periods of time, but there may also be short-term interest mentions. Okay, so let me just go to them one by one. So we go back to what exactly is the period? We may have some idea, but we are going to get an idea of what is the period of Satapatha Brahmana from this. So I'm just going to quote you a few aspects about the sky which have been mentioned in various literatures. Okay, so here I have taken Indian literature from very ancient times, and in this there is one mention in that second Brahmana, as it says, that he may set up two fires under the Kritika, for they, the Kritikas, are doubtless Agnis Astral. This is a translation, of course. What essentially this is saying is that Kritikas rise exactly in the east, and we will see that this means that they are, I mean, on the equator. This is one mention way back ancient time. I'm just giving you a couple of mentions and we'll go on to talk about positional astronomy. Vedanga Jyotisha of Lagada, once again we will try and find out what is the period when this was. So here there is a mention of the sun and the moon, of course, is not that important. Sun is the slower moving one. So in the region of the zodiac, a asterism called Shravishta. So we also need to actually get an idea about Indian star names and so on, which nowadays, of course, we can find a lot of those just online easily. So I'm in fact going to just pick up a Wikipedia article for that. But of course, there is a good amount of work going on in terms of identifying which nakshatra we are identifying with modern day nakshatra and so on. So there is that. And as far as I remember, this Shravishta is probably related to Castor Pollux or so. We'll take a look. I've done this again and again, but I keep forgetting which star is which. All right. And then it talks about, what does it say? It says that the sun, as it is going northwards and southwards in its annual movement, somebody is expressing surprise that the sun is going as far as the Shravishta before it turns back in its Uttarayan and Dakshinayan. The fact that they are surprised means also that perhaps they had an idea from some other literature and so on earlier that it did not do this maybe at one time, but now it is doing this. So this is one which was mentioned. So these are just a couple of examples I am telling you. We'll come to these later. And then we come to a little more. Ahead of these mentions in history, we come to Varahamihira, 6th century AD, and he said that in his time, summer solstice happened when the sun went all the way to Punarvasu, and winter solstice happened when the sun went to Uttarashada. Once again, these are the 27 nakshatra which are there in Indian astronomy. Moon comes near one of these nakshatra in every tithi and so on. You will perhaps all be aware that Indian astronomy has this lunisolar kind of calendrical notions, where the moon is near some star and sun is near some star and so on. Now, all of these topics actually are going to need a whole separate talk altogether. I'm not doing that right now. I'm just giving you a few examples of just statements back in history which said that, which in a way work for us. We can do a little bit of detective work looking at these statements. Detective work about when these statements were made. And why is it that we are able to make all of this? We will know when we talk of the positional astronomy. So then there is something about the list of nakshatras starting at the Mrigashira nakshatra. And so which is being inferred as the sun being near the Mrigashira nakshatra in this statement. This is, as I have taken from Introduction to Astronomy, Professor S. Balchandra Rao, from that. So these are a couple of mentions I have made from ancient astronomy. Just keep in mind. Now, these kinds of mentions of sun near a particular star at a particular time of the year, that's what these are. So these are slightly, you know, like over a period of year and over a period of several years, that these become of importance. There may also be much shorter mentions, like, you know, just the direction where the sun rises, etc. Well, if any of you have read Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, so there is a statement there which talks about, I mean, there are a couple of people in the story there waiting before sunrise, and they're talking about where the sun is going to rise. And there's very long discussion about, somebody says the sun is going to rise here, then someone says, no, sun is going to rise here, and few days back it used to rise there, and so on. So all of this encompasses, all these mentions I have made encompass ideas about positional astronomy. So now let's look at some of these aspects. But maybe before we look at aspects of positional astronomy, what we should do now is, let me change my screen share and I will share the Stellarium app that I have before we go on to practical positional astronomy. Are you able to see the Stellarium
yes,
app which I have shared? All right. So here I've already opened it. Many of you are familiar with it, but some may not be familiar. So Stella, remember Stella, S-E-L-L-A, Stellarium. That is the software. Download it. In fact, I should have had asked you all to download and keep it ready and explore along with me. So this is the sky in your hands. You can actually explore the sky in your hands through this. Of course, I should also mention to you, don't just stick to this. It's great fun. You know, just using the Stellarium app, and you get to know so many things about positional astronomy using this app. But don't confine yourself to this. Go out, look at the real sky, and try to kind of, you know, tally what you see here with what you see for the real sky. And the main thing which I'm telling you is, while you're doing all of this, try to make small measurements wherever, whatever possible, so that you get a good grip on you. If you do this, your understanding of all of this will enhance orders of magnitude. If you listen to my talk, if you just use one software or small. Let me see my internet. It seems all right. Maybe I should just put out my video. Oh, I've already put out my video.
Don't worry, ma'am. You're audible now. In the middle, it was you can say a couple of sentences which were with the broken one.
Huh. All right. So what I was saying was that use this app, and many of you, I'm sure, have already done this. Here, I'm just fast forwarding the time, and we take a look. Oh, it's giving us a few other things, some little extra stuff which is here. So if I remove it out of F11, are you still seeing it? You have to tell me. I have removed it out of F11 now, I think. Are you still seeing it?
Yes, ma'am.
The stars and so on. And I see that I think I have pulsars somewhere. I'll remove the pulsars from it. There are also meteor showers. I'll remove that. I'll just keep the stars and the planets if they are there. Solar system objects. And so this is the night sky that we are seeing. And you can see all the directions, etc. mentioned. Those of you who have not done sky observations as of now, so far, use this to do sky observations. You can see here, looking towards the direction north, you can see the Saptarishi. So I think it goes, which way does it go? Kritu, Pula, Pulastya, Atri, Angiras, Vashishta, Marichi. Anyway, seven stars our ancients imagined, and of course every culture has looked at this because this is a very prominent constellation and it shows you the direction of pole star. These two stars point out the direction to pole star and so on. And you can see a few of the other stars. You can get star names. Actually learn to use these kind of help which is there, and it will allow you to see all that you want to see. Get an idea about what is there in the sky. You can have more labels, more stars. You can say you want to see stars up to some magnitude or not. There is a lot to learn in this. Now, if those of you who have never used this before, this quick run through is not going to really help you so much. But if you keep using it, and then maybe all of you join into some group and have discussions with others, I'm sure there are many of you who are very well aware of this, who can help you with this. But it will be good to use this to get to know the sky. And if you are in cities, of course, you may not see all of this. You may be seeing much less. Where is the light pollution? I can increase the light pollution perhaps. Then you will see much, much less of stars. This is the kind of skies that we have from Delhi and so on. So, but at least when we are using virtual, why use light pollutions, light polluted skies? Let's keep all the stars. Okay, so these are the stars which are there, and with time we see that what's happening to them. We can have some idea how they are moving in the sky. You can see that the shapes of the constellations remain the same, although the positions in the sky, they keep changing. Look at this, Saptarishi continues to point out the pole star to you. And when you're looking towards the north, what is the direction in which the stars are rising and setting? We can take a note. let's take a look in the southern direction and run the time again. So as the time runs, you can see the direction in which the stars appear to rise and set. So clockwise, anti-clockwise, all of this. So these are things which are happening in the sky all the time. And living in busy cities, we actually miss it. You know, just looking at the software, we can realize it so easily. But if you look at the real sky, it's going to take us to some time, really, to get an idea that all this is happening. What you see when you see the sky, night sky, is that you will see... Well, you may not see all these many stars. If you are in smaller towns, maybe you'll see quite a number of stars. And let me remove all the labels whatsoever. So this is what we will see. And even after I removed all the labels, there's still solar system objects labels. Let's remove. And so this is what you will see. And even the directions are actually not given to you. You will have to figure out yourself. But you see these bunch of lights in the sky, and they seem to be just there stationary if you initially look at them. But it will take you some time to notice that, no, they are moving in the sky. But it's not so easy to, the way you can do it in the software. For real, if you want to do a measurement, you'll have to have some kind of frame of reference, which will allow you to notice what is the positions of these objects in the sky. And that is where positional astronomy comes in. You want to know what are the positions of these objects in the sky, and are these objects remaining in the same location all the time? You know that the sun rises and sets and so on. And so do the stars do the same? Yeah, it seems that they do the same. Maybe we just take a look, because the software helps you a lot. You can see what's happening. So you see that stars rise and set, sun rises and sets. When the sun sets, you'll see the nighttime objects. And they all seem to rise in the east and set in the west. And is that true universally? Let's take a look here. Now I run the time and you see what's happening. What are the stars doing? Are they all rising in the east and setting in the west? If I keep the time ticking, I can't use the mouse to do anything else. So you'll have to see for yourself. Look at the pole star. That's pole star. Look at stars above pole stars and pole star, and look at stars below pole star. What's happening? What is the direction in which they are moving? So the ones below pole star are actually moving west to east. These are moving east to west. The objects are going around the pole star. There are some stars which are actually never rising and setting, but they are what are called circumpolar. So they are going around the pole star, and if I could actually put on star trails, I don't know how to do that in Stellarium, you'll actually see the kind of circles that they are forming and so on. So this is one thing. Let's do one more thing. Geography. Let's go somewhere near the equator. So for that, what I need to do is, let's put this 0. All right, this, let me just decrease. What is happening? I want to put the, we are nearly at the equator on this. Now, let's look at how stars rise and set. We are nearly on the equator. Let's look at the direction east and let's run the time. See what's happening to stars? As they rise, they're rising vertically towards the east, right? They're rising vertically towards the east. Now let's come back to Delhi. What do I do? I maybe search out Delhi. New Delhi. So let's come back to Delhi. And we are looking towards the direction east, and let's make the stars rise. What's happening? How are they rising? Are they rising perpendicularly from the east, the way we saw in the at the equator? No, they're slightly tilted. The direction of the sun, stars rising is a little tilted towards the south, right? Like, take a look again. See, they're moving to. So these are all the kinds of what are called aspects of positional astronomy which have been noticed over millennia. Our idea of positional astronomy has got, its understanding from thousands of years of observations. Yet, there are so many aspects of this we are not immediately aware of. Maybe some of you were not quite aware of the aspects which I pointed out using this software. So if you use this software yourself, you can actually check out a lot of these. Go to North Pole and see what happens. Let's just be somewhere over there. And let's run the time. So the sun is circling there. That's the 6 months night, 6 months day, etc., etc. Or you move the month a little further. Oh no, you are going to the summer months. Yeah. Go to the winter months and run the time. The sun is never there in the sky. The stars are circling the pole star, which is roughly overhead, and so on. You know all these aspects, perhaps. I mean, qualitatively, you know, you are aware of all of this. But you can take a look at them through a software like this to get a much better feel for these. And more than all of this, what you need to do is, let's just come back to our place, Delhi. More than all of this, well, that is where I am. Of course, not all of you may be in Delhi. Why is it not showing me Delhi? Okay, whatever. Let's just come somewhere here in India. And that's where we are. Now, more than any other thing, when we are observing the sky and so on, qualitatively, we want to know what is out there in the sky. But more than that, it would be much more fun for us to have a little bit of a quantitative idea of what's happening in the sky. For this quantitative idea, there are certain ways of quantifying this circle of the sky. And that's positional astronomy. So the first part which comes in this quantification is a localized quantification, meaning that I probably may need visually, because I'm going to show a few things, probably just using my bangles or something. But first, let's take a look at the sky. And the sky is we have kind of taken the sky over our head, stretched it out, and made this circle. So this is the overhead point, and we have north, south, east, west, etc., etc. All of these are there. Now, we want to kind of divide this into some kind of a graph. We want to look at it like a graph. And so for that, this will do. Let me just check. Yeah, this will do. So we have kind of drawn a graph in the sky. What is this graph? So what happens is that, see, because this is the surface of a hemisphere that we are looking at and not the full sphere, meaning the distance along line of sight we are not bothered about. So we need only two coordinates to describe everything in this. So in these two coordinates, one is the altitude, which is like, maybe you have done it in trigonometry, heights and distances. So you look towards the horizon and you look towards a star and drop a perpendicular from the star on the horizon. And actually this angle to the star and to the horizon, this angle is called altitude. So that is one angle. And the other angle is when you drop a perpendicular at the horizon, mark that point P, start the direction north, move eastwards and come to the point P. So this angle is called azimuth. So there are two angles which are actually going to define where objects are in the sky. So that is what you can see here. Those two angles, actually, the altitude is along this radial direction of this circle here. So these are actually, these circles define different altitude. Altitude at this horizon is 0. Altitude at the center is 90. And these divisions are giving you the different altitude values. Azimuth is in the circumferential direction. So azimuth towards the north is 0. And you move eastwards. And so 360 degrees of azimuth is defined here. So that is what is defined in this grid that you can see. So you will see that stars or any object in the sky, you can say what is its altitude and azimuth. You know, it's actually now in this you can read off, they give you the altitude and azimuth here. Oh, by the way, let me just stop the time, otherwise that will also I'll stop the time for now. Okay, so then the altitude and azimuth can be read off for each of these objects. Maybe you try doing it for anyone which is easier here without actually going to check it out. So this is zero azimuth, right? So this fellow is at zero azimuth. And what are these circles? What altitude are they doing? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So each of these circles seems to be defining 10 degree of altitude, right? So this is 0 altitude, 10, 20, and that's 30. So that's about 25 altitude. And this is azimuth 0. Let's see whether our estimate is right. Okay. Azimuth altitude. What's going on here? 25 altitude is fine. I don't know how we have got the don't quite understand. Let's just check with some other fellow for altitude azimuth. That's giving you about 47. I don't know whether whatever that is, there is some issue here. But normally you take this as zero azimuth and move this way. Yeah, this azimuth sounds right. Because this is zero and you are moving this way. This is going to be 90. That's about 45. And yeah, this azimuth is all right. I don't quite figure out what's wrong, went wrong here. Here, this should be closer to 90 azimuth. Yeah, 80 degrees and so on. So many of you, I'm sure, are aware of this definition of altitude and azimuth. But those of you who have not, familiar with it, now I'm going to do one thing. I'm going to move time and you will see that the altitude and azimuth of objects is changing, right? Naturally, they are rising and setting, so their position in the local sky is changing. On the other hand, this is a local coordinate system. We can actually also define a coordinate system, and maybe for this I should now go to my presentation and and then we'll come back to Stellarium later. Let me go to my presentation and share it. And all right, this is actually the definition for the local altitude azimuth, which I had talked about, height, angular height, and azimuth. But on the other hand, as you saw, the altitude azimuth was changing with time and so on. Not only that, if you were actually to go to another location, the values of altitude azimuth would be different. I could have shown that also. I didn't show it. So you could actually talk of quantities which are not changing with your location and position. If you go to a framework where you go to the center of the earth as your center of your observation instead of your eye as the center, as which was for the local coordinates. So you may have the global coordinate system where center of the earth is the center. And then what do? You take the equator. I don't know, is my video visible?
Slides are visible.
Yeah. Now I'm just put out my video also. You take the equator of the sky and put that equator, throw it up into the sky. Okay? You get a circle like this. Then along the equator and parallel to the equator and perpendicular to the equator, you can define coordinates. But you need a starting point, right? This here, everything is equal. Well, you have another circle in the sky. You take the annual apparent path of the sun and throw it up into the sky. You know that like the sun appears to move in the sky. We also know that because the earth is going around the sun, the background in which we see the sun keeps changing. We divide that into 12 pieces and we call that the zodiac. We'll see the zodiac constellations as well. And so the sun appears to move around in that zodiac constellation. And so the central line in which the sun appears to move, we call that the ecliptic. And so we have the equator and we have the ecliptic. They meet at two points. And these two points are actually called the equinoxes. Today we are meeting for the equinox, right? So maybe it's good that we go through what this is. So these two points are the equinoxes. We have the March equinox and the September equinox. And so this is the spring equinox and autumn equinox for northern hemisphere. So we take this March equinox as the zero point. And if we go along the equator, we define one coordinate. And if you go perpendicular to the equator, we define another coordinate. And so these are called the right ascension and declination. And these are going to be the same. Once we measure right ascension and declination for any object from anywhere on Earth, they are going to be the same because the original definition is with respect to center of the Earth. So this is another kind of coordinate system. In fact, we have another coordinate system too. After a while, we'll go on to look at some Jantar Mantar instruments, which will help us measure these coordinates. Well, the coordinates may sound a little dry, and I hope I'm not boring all of you. But if you actually start making some measurements, then they become very exciting. So I'll tell you how to do some measurements as well. Okay. So I'll probably talk about maybe just couple of measurements, and I also want you to be able to build a small instrument which will show you when you are having the equinox. That may be quite exciting. So I hope all of you will make that instrument. But before we do that, where was I? I was talking about the equinoxes and the ecliptic. Yeah, you also have another kind of coordinate system where instead of going along the equator, you may actually go along the ecliptic and perpendicular to the ecliptic and so on. So these are called ecliptic coordinates. If you get time, I'll talk a little more in detail about these different coordinates. But I think I would like to tell you two things which is possible for everyone to do. And we have to actually talk a little bit about Jantar Mantar instruments because they bring alive this concept. But not all of you will have access to the Jantar Mantar instruments, right? So therefore, I want to talk about possible instruments you can make yourself, which will help you measure these coordinates. One of the simplest, and perhaps many of you have done this, is if you have a protractor, let's say. Take the D protractor, is that what it is called? Take that and maybe trace its shape on, or get one of those engineering drawing ones, the large ones. Trace the shape on a piece of cardboard or something. So make your instrument with that. And from the center of the protractor, put a nail or something and hang a thread with rope on it. Then you take the protractor, the central line, and point it towards the sky. The rope will hang down, and by gravity, it will come perpendicularly downwards. And then you can read the angle the star is making, the altitude angle. So that is one. I think Nav Nirmiti calls it angled angle meter. Almost every astronomy education effort starts with asking you to make such an instrument to measure altitudes. And you could perhaps also use that instrument to get an idea about azimuth. You just hold it flat and just turn the rope around till you come to where the object is in the sky. Look at the direction north and you can actually measure azimuth. So altitude and azimuth with a simple handmade instrument is easy to measure. And if some of you would like to do it and it is not yet clear in my discussion what was said, we could have a little more detailed discussion about it towards the end. So that is one instrument that all of you can make, everybody can make, to make those measurements. And for right ascension and declination, the measurements are going to be a little trickier. You would, even if you have make a simple equinoxial sundial, you could make some of these measurements. We'll talk about some of the instruments and maybe how to make models of some of these instruments in a little while. But as far as the right ascension and declination are concerned, here you see the two circles, imaginary circles we have taken out, then with center at the center of the Earth. And so you have the equator and this is the North Pole. So along the equator, 360 degrees of that is actually divided into 24 hours of time. And so we have our right ascension in hours, minutes, seconds, and the declination in degrees, plus 90 up till here, minus 90 up till here. So this defines, in fact, objects in the sky. And we can actually put this out, this right ascension and declination, let's put that out in our software. So let me now share once again the software. And so let me come to the Stellarium software, which we are looking at. Remember this, the altitude and azimuth, which are there. Now we can look for other kind of markings. So we have something called the equatorial grid. So I put that first. And it's a little difficult to see. It's in green color. The blue colored one is the, wait a second. No, the green colored is the altitude azimuth. The blue colored is the right ascension declination. You will recognize it from this fact that the altitude azimuth, the zero, the zenith, the point is here. So it's our overhead point becomes special in the altitude azimuth. But where the pole star is becomes special for the right ascension declination. And so this is the equator, and 90 degree away from it, where the pole star is. And now take a look. If we move the time, it may not be so easy to see, but see the grid itself, the blue grid is moving. The green grid is stationary. The blue grid itself is moving as we move time, because this is centered at the Earth, and the definition of right ascension and declination for any of these objects, they remain the same. With time, if you change the time, if you change the location, and so on. Take Stellarium and then make these explorations carefully for yourself. And you may also want to know, for instance, if you look at this object here, this is the equator. So you will know that this is, look at this, this Orion, this the third star here in Orion, which is this fellow? The name they are not giving, but they have common names also. This star away from the knife of Orion, passing very close to the equator. And so on. So you may, I mean, there are various kinds of interesting things which you want to know about the sky. In the sky, you will not have all this help, all these grids and so on. So you can use these grids in the software and then look up at the real sky. And you know, the classic amateur astronomers were so aware of all of this. They would know, I mean, they would look at any of the stars, know which is the direction where the equator, which are the stars on the equator, which is the direction towards the center of the galaxy, which are the stars, which are the constellations, or all of those just by looking at the night sky without any of this software. The classical astronomers were aware by reading books and following the sky, but now we have a lot of help for this. All right, there is one other kind of grid, which is the ecliptic grid. I told you there are three different kinds of coordinates. Now this has become very, very confusing, right? The orange is the ecliptic grid, and you can see now this is the ecliptic pole. What would be the ecliptic pole? I hope if my video is still on. Is my video? Okay, I'll put it on just once more and then I'll put it off. So this is the equator and this is the ecliptic. So the along the ecliptic, you have the what is called the ecliptic longitude, and perpendicular to the ecliptic, you'll have what are called the ecliptic latitudes. And so the pole of the ecliptic, 90 degree away from the ecliptic, will be what that orange circle that we are seeing. Let's take a look at that. And so that's the pole of the ecliptic. That's the pole of the equator. That's the pole of our local coordinate system. So you see, so many complicated things we are drawing in the sky. How do we actually measure any of these things? To measure any of these things, it would be good for us to go to an observatory like the Jantar Mantar Observatory. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble with my... let me just see. I'll have to do a different screen share now to try to show you some of the Jantar Mantar Observatory slides I have. Perhaps I don't have the very necessary ones that I need, but let me just check if I have... I don't seem to be having quite the slides that I want, but okay, here we can take a look at the Delhi Observatory in this slide, and we have the Samrat Yantra, which actually tells time. It can actually do equal kind of measurements, but I've exceeded my time.
No, ma'am.
You are not able to see the slides.
Yeah.
You're not able to see the screen. Achha, let me just see if I can share it again. Yes, can you see it now?
Yes, ma'am.
The Jantar Mantar Observatory?
Yes, ma'am.
So I have a few slides of this observatory instrument. In fact, this is one instrument I would like you to make. This is the model I was going to tell you, because this instrument, this is called the Nadi Valaya. It allows you to actually know when the equinox has arrived. So perhaps I should concentrate on this. But since I talked about the coordinates, let me just look up one instrument of the observatory. And I can see it partially here. This is called the Ram Yantra. Let me see if I have any other slide of it. There you are. This is all the Samrat. Yeah, this is the Ram Yantra. Because I talked of coordinates, the local, the equatorial and the ecliptic, at least one set of coordinates, let me tell you how they can be measured. And that set of coordinates is the local one. And this kind of an instrument, the Ram Yantra, it is there in Delhi and it is there in Jaipur. And Varanasi has a partial instrument called the Digamsa, which, and even Ujjain has. Maybe you could make a model of the Ram Yantra too. This is relatively simple to make. So let me explain the principle of it. And the Ram Yantra, actually, there are made in, there are two cylinders, which are the Ram Yantra, both in Jaipur as well as in Delhi. And that's because you actually walk into the instrument to make the measurements. But if you are making a small model, you can make a single one and a single cylindrical model. One of the amateur astronomers who has been working with us over a long time, Snake Kesri, he made a model, maybe a tabletop size model. And what do you do here? What is essentially happening here? You have a kind of a cylindrical instrument. And the cylindrical instrument, the inside surface of the cylinder reflects the sky. Every point in the sky is a point in the inner surface of this cylinder. And there is a central pillar. So the central pillar is the main instrument, actually. So it's like in the daytime, it's the shadow of the central pillar that we see inside this instrument, which tells us what? It actually tells us the altitude and azimuth of the sun. Exactly what we were discussing. One of the positional astronomy coordinate systems, the local coordinate system, altitude, which is the angular height of an object, and azimuth, which is the north, south, east, west direction, can be measured very nicely here. And in fact, there's one student, Megha Rajoria, who took hundreds of measurements of altitude and azimuth with the Delhi Observatory. And I may be having the graphs of some of her measurements here too, somewhere. So kind of to get an idea of how accurate the instrument is to measure this. What is the principle behind the measurement? I don't know if I have, here we have a closer look at least at the observatory instrument. See this pillar? So the sun somewhere here, sunlight falls on the pillar, falls inside. It may fall on the wall or it may fall on the inner. You can see here, there is a floor sectors. So what happens is altitude, let me see if I have the triangle. This is the Ram Yantra in Jaipur. I don't have the schematic of it here, unfortunately. But you imagine the schematic. The sunlight comes and falls here and goes and falls somewhere here. You can make a kind of a right angle triangle out of it. And the altitude is actually the angle between the hypotenuse and the base. So if you know this height and if you know this length, you can measure the altitude. So actually this height is made to be equal to the wall height, equal to the floor length actually. So what happens is that when the sun is at 45 degree altitude, the shadow is at the junction between wall and the floor. And when the sun is at zero altitude, the shadow is at top. If the sun were at 90 degree altitude, the shadow would be zero. But from Delhi and Jaipur, of course, that is never happening. But you can build a kind of a cylindrical instrument like this with an inner gnomon like this and divide this. Now, as far as the azimuth is concerned, you can simply divide it into equal degrees. 360 degrees of azimuth can be divided easily, linearly. But as far as altitude is concerned, you have to put the trigonometry into it. So it is this height and this length of the shadow which will give you the tangent. So you have to actually put the tangents accordingly. And depending on the size of your instrument, you can make an instrument like this and measure for the sun. You can measure the altitude and azimuth through the day. Of course, the larger the instrument, the better least count, and which is what Jai Singh aimed at, making this gigantic instrument. So do make a visit to one of these observatories, certainly whenever you can, and try and make some measurements of this kind. And maybe we'll be in touch more and I could help you a little more in getting an idea about that. But there's one instrument, it's here also. You can see this. This instrument is called a Nadi Valaya. This is in Ujjain. And let's go to the Jaipur one. We saw it a while ago. I'm not talking about all these details. If there is time, I'll see. This is the Nadi Valaya. Now, actually, I had a very beautiful video of it somewhere, but I'm not able to find it just now. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go to Google Images and see if we can get an idea of Nadi Valaya from all directions. And I'll have to share that, of course. Let me just check. Yeah, so I see a few of these. Let me do the share now. of that. The Google images that I have. Hey, where is that? Yeah. I have so many things open, I'm not able to figure out where that is. Yeah, there it is. So I hope you are able to see the Google images which I am trying to show of the Nadivalaya instrument. Here is a model of it. And so this is you see one face of it. This is another face actually. This is the south facing clock dial of the Nadivalaya. This is a north facing one. How do you know? See, the south facing is tilted forward a little. It's tilted to the south. Both faces are tilted to the south in such a way that this circle is actually parallel to the equator. And so there is a rod coming out of it, which is then becomes perpendicular to the equator. It points to the pole star, and the shadow of this rod falling here swings along like this, and you can actually tell the time. So this is the Nadivalaya. This is the south facing wall, and behind it will be the north facing wall. And if you can, here you can see this is the north facing wall and this is the south facing wall, and both are tilted the same way, tilted towards the south. So depending on what is your latitude, so if your latitude is actually equator, then they would be just sleeping, and as you go north of the equator, they'll go up a little, and in such a way that you have to tilt them. If you are 20 degree above the equator, then you tilt them so that this angle then is going to be, I mean, from here 80 degree down 20 degrees, so that it becomes parallel to the equator. So you can build such an Nadivalaya instrument. Take maybe that empty roll of toilet paper or something, make it sit on a stand. So the stand will have to be like this. Make a stand like this, some kind of, like a thick cardboard stand. And it cannot be equal heights. It has to be tilted like this so that the tilt becomes equal to, just like you have on the Samrat Yantra, you have to make the angle equal to the latitude. So this has to be tilted down in such a way that this becomes parallel to the equator. The clock face becomes parallel to the equator. So you can just make an instrument of this kind. It's relatively simple to do. And again, today's lecture may not quite be sufficient for us to discuss all the nitty-gritties. Maybe if some of you are interested, join one of the WhatsApp groups that we have, which are doing, I mean, I think the best WhatsApp group to join is the Samantha Challenge group. In fact, I wanted to tell about those kind of measurements too. Maybe after this, I will mention that. So join the Samantha Challenge. Amritanshu Vajpayee can give you the link for it. And we will discuss how this can be made. A model of the Nadivalaya. And why do we want to do this? Well, because there are all kinds of sundial measurement instruments which can make, but this has one peculiar aspect that although it is, I mean, a small one, medium precision kind of instrument, this is a little bit of nitty-gritty I don't want to get into. This comes from details of observations I did with the different kinds of sundials, so maybe we'll talk about this in the group. But this has one advantage that when you look at the shadow, it's the center of the shadow which is going to tell you the time. Unlike the umbra penumbra edge of the shadow, which happens in the Samrat Yantra kind of instruments. So that gives you an advantage in terms of accuracy for time. So, but whatever that is, this also tells you one thing. It tells you when an equinox has approached. You see, what happens is that away from the equinox, this instrument is active. On the days of the instrument, after days of the equinox, this instrument is not active. You will not see sun shadow on the face of it on the day, exact day of the equinox. One day before, one day later, you will see shadows. Well, you will see shadow on the southern side of the instrument past today kind of equinox. Southern side, no, in the winter. This becomes active after the September equinox. After the September equinox, you'll start seeing the sun coming on this. September to March, you will see the shadow here. March to September, you will see the shadow on the other one, the north facing one. So one half of the sundial is active in the summer and one half is in the winter. But on the days of the equinox, there'll be no shadow on the clock faces. So you will get to know that equinox has come by looking at this. So today being the equinox day, I thought this would be a good instrument to talk about. So here there are some renderings of it in jantarmantra.org. which you can take a look at, but it will be very nice. A simple instrument you can make out of maybe just toilet paper roll, or if you want to make it a much larger one, it should be possible to do. And so that is one thing I wanted to mention. I don't know how much time I actually have. I also then perhaps should talk about, let's maybe use the stellarium only to talk about angles in the sky. Let me get rid of all these. Oh, there was one thing I started by telling about those few ancient mentions, right? I should close that. Why I mentioned that, I should give you an idea about. So let me just, yeah, here are the solstices and the equinoxes. And these are actually given, see, this is an equinox here. This is a symbol for the equinox and so on. So this is a symbol for the solstice. Now, I may not be able to go through the detail. Amritanshu, I don't know how much time I have, but I just wanted to ask you, maybe I leave this as an exercise. I am perhaps done a lot. I mean, I probably overshot my time. But let me just leave it as an exercise too. You can actually go back and forth in time using this. You know that, right? Let me actually remove the atmosphere perhaps so that, you know, like once I remove the atmosphere, we can see the sun as well as the stars. You can actually go back in time. You put a minus here, you are going to BC times. So now we are back in history. And now you learn to explore this closely. This is the equinox. And you can now move the time, maybe days and so on, and see where the moon is, where the sun is. This is the moon. Let's get the sun in the picture. Where is the sun? Probably we need to move the time. Get the sun in the picture. There is the sun. And so where is the sun located with respect to the equinoxes? And with respect to the background stars, that is what the earlier exploration which I mentioned was about. So see, this is where the sun has, this is probably, this is a symbol probably for the winter solstice. So the sun has reached the winter solstice. What are the stars near the sun? And so on. So we will see that, see, this is the winter solstice. And okay, let's put out the constellations. Let's forget about the star names for now. Let's very quickly just look at the constellations. That will tell us labels. Okay, the sun is at winter solstice and it is here. Oh, which solstice is this? Now I'm a little confused about the symbols too. This is one of the symbols. I had a slide which explains to us what are the symbols. We'll take a look. But what you can do is locate where the sun is, move your ear around and see how it changes. And you will find that the position of the sun at the time of equinox or at the time of solstice in the background of constellations changes, but doesn't change this year, next year and so on, but it changes over hundreds of years, thousands of years. Why does it change? You are all perhaps aware of it. And it changes because the axis of rotation of Earth. So Earth spins around this axis of rotation. It gives us our night and day. Earth goes around the sun. It gives us the year. The axis of rotation also spins. It also precesses like a top. So that precession gives us these long-term changes that we see. I don't know which I am sharing. I hope you are able to see the stellarium. So because of that precision, if you change your time, let's look at this. So this is 2000 year BC, right? Let's make it 2000 AD. And so now you can see that when the sun comes near this, it's at a different constellation or so. It's a different constellation when sun is near this point. And so on. So this change of the sun in the background where we see it through precession, actually, in Indian astronomy, this is called, taken called Ayanamsa, change in Ayanamsa, which is happening, precession of equinoxes, which we talk of. So all those changes that I noted down for you are coming about because of this precession. So that is the longest term that we normally have from observations of, and this is a periodicity of 26,000 years. And so this can also be determined through your positional astronomy observations. And if you do modern astronomy, you will find that the stars and they're given the names from their positions. So we give so and so right ascension, so and so declination, but we also refer to something called the epoch, because right ascension and declination over a period of I mean, like over a period of our lifetime, when we are observing this, they may not be changing so much. They are the same. I told you, altitude azimuth changes, but right ascension declination doesn't change. But that also changes over longer periods because of precession. And so that is how we have these definitions according to epoch. That is how we have these changes which are happening. What we saw in the Satapatha Brahmana and with Vedanga Jyotisha, those were mentions from positional astronomy, which allowed us to understand from precision the time when this happened. I didn't actually take you through that because I've really overshot my time. But perhaps we could do a more practical session. Once again, as a follow-up, let's all, maybe those of you who are interested, join the WhatsApp group and we will talk of this. By the way, the Samantha Challenge WhatsApp group I mentioned also started from one such positional astronomy endeavors, which we talked about, that look at the sky, look at any two objects in the sky and try to measure the angle between those two objects. Generally, for stars, etc., the angles won't change. But the angle between sun and the objects, of course, it's not easy for us to do that measurement. But with the moon, we can measure the angle between moon and any star will keep changing. Of course, every day it changes. But angle between faraway planets like Saturn and Jupiter change much slowly. But we had recently a dramatic manifestation of that in December 2020, when Jupiter and Saturn came very close. And we had this Samantha Chandrasekhar challenge, inspired from Samantha Chandrasekhar of Orissa, late 19th century, early 20th century astronomer, who did these kind of positional astronomy measurement with very simple handmade instruments. And so we suggested one such handmade instrument, which is a cross staff. And perhaps Amritanshu can talk about that whole project at some time for your club. And Amritanshu and many of the others, I think Gaurav is also there amongst you. So, and perhaps there are others too. They all made wonderful measurements of this changing angle. And that's also a positional astronomy measurement. So I think I should probably stop at this point in the walkthrough and take up any questions, and then perhaps I can go to.
Thank you, ma'am.
I overshot my time.
No, ma'am. Actually, it is just exactly at the time, so no need to worry for. And so there are a lot of queries as far as the WhatsApp group link are concerned. Don't worry, we shall share it on the relevant forum. So there have been, you can say, a lot of queries, because a lot of people, what they had done is, there is a group of teachers and students, so they were showing this talk projected on a particular platform to their students. So we have been receiving a lot of queries. So out of that, myself and my co-host Susatya Rekha ma'am, we have taken up a few relevant queries, and if you permit, ma'am, can we take up a few amongst them?
Yeah, sure. And if there are school students, I'm just wondering whether I went as basic as I should have had gone. Maybe I didn't quite go as basic as I should have
actually, the way in which the queries have come, it means that students were following you as far as the level of understanding was concerned from them. So now I just would like to bring into picture Susatya Rekha ma'am. Ma'am, if you can kindly unmute yourself and put the queries, the most relevant of the queries that have reached your mail inbox, over to Rekha ma'am. Then I shall take a couple from my part. Rekha ma'am, kindly unmute yourself.
You are muted, Rekha ji.
Rekha ma'am, we are okay. I have asked you to unmute, ma'am. Kindly unmute.
Okay. Good evening, ma'am. I'm also from Andhra Pradesh. మా వాళ్ళందరూ కూడా, మా టీచర్స్ అందరూ కూడా ఇందులో పార్టిసిపేట్ చేసిన వాళ్ళు చాలా మంది మిమ్మల్ని కలిసారు. వెరీ నైస్ మేడం. మేము ఎక్కడికో
వెళ్ళిపోయాం.
అబౌట్ this, what is the difference between astism you told in the beginning and constellation? Mrs. Sukha ma'am is asking.
Yes. I don't know if my screen share is still there. I think it is there. No, you can. No, let me just, because that will help us answer many a question. Let me keep the screen share. So yeah, it is these differences. Asterisms usually Okay, let me just remove all the extra stuff so that it will help us discuss. So when people observed all of these objects in the sky, many a time they used to weave different stories into these, what they observed in the sky, and they became the constellations. So for instance, like this is Cassiopeia, this group, if I don't know if I can show the figures themselves, let me just see. There must be artwork. Artwork. Yes. So people imagined when they saw these stars, like here, this is Taurus, the bull, and so on. This is a ram, and there's a fish, and these are all imaginary shapes. There is nothing really, no science in these shapes, but a lot of imagination. People looked at these, and it's also interesting sometimes how people imagine the same shapes and sometimes different kinds of shapes in these groups. So these groups are the constellations. Look at this Cygnus, the swan. So it's like a gigantic swan flying north south. And now if I just remove the label, you imagine, try and imagine the swan yourself. Oh, it's a little difficult to do that. I can't. Okay. No, if you come to the planetarium, I could do that much more easily. But anyway, so these are the kinds of shapes which are imagined and names given to these objects. So these are constellations. Asterisms are groupings which are not actually part of these constellations. So if you look at, for instance, this one, this star in Cygnus and this star in Aquila and this in Lyra, this is called the summer triangle. So it's not one constellation, but this group. So this group is an asterism. Saptarishi itself, it is actually, it's an asterism. It's not a constellation. The constellation is the Big Dipper. But if there are some specific shapes and which are not part of this constellation, they're asterisms. So that's all. That's the difference.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Madam Gauru Chaurasia is asking, how did ancient astronomers come to know about equinox?
Yeah, that's a very, very nice, very good question.
Yes.
See, from down from Earth, what is it that we notice with respect to the seasons? With respect to the seasons, we actually notice the north-south movement of the sun, what is called Uttarayan and Dakshinayan. That we do notice. So if we look at, let me get rid of everything here, which may confuse, and we will just look at the stars and try to think of what our ancients may have seen. So one observation.
Excuse me, ma'am, your audio link seems to be broken a little bit.
You look at where the sun is rising. All right, so maybe without the screen share and so on, let me, is it better now?
Yes, ma'am, maybe yes, ma'am.
If I stop screen,
yes, ma'am.
And just use gestures to explain. Maybe I'll just use gestures to explain and no screen share. Okay, so what you do is the direction of sunrise. And you will see that it is sometime rising exactly east. Then it goes a little northwards. Then it comes back again exactly east, then it goes southwards. So this north-south swing of the direction of sunrise or sunset is what we call Uttarayan and Dakshinayan. And Uttarayan and Dakshinayan observations gave an idea about equinoxes and solstices and all of this. If the sun is rising exactly east, that is the, well, of course, there are going to be differences in that, topocentric differences a little in that, but overall, this is one thing. And if you make sky observations, you can have some idea. Like where the sun is exactly in the sky, the background you don't see in the night time. Otherwise, the rest of it in that circle, along the ecliptic, you will see either in the morning or in the night time. So you will actually have an idea of the position of the sun in the background of constellations by seeing what is it that you don't see, because that part is right behind the sun. So you can get an idea about all of these, in fact, the coordinates and everything, by knowing what you are seeing, where you are seeing the sun in the sky and so on. So you can correlate where is the sun in the sky with whether or not it has reached the equinox or whether it has reached the maximum southwards and the maximum. So all of this, that is how ancient observations we do have, which tell us that sun was at equinox or at Kritikas, where at the equator or the Shravishta at solstice and so on. That is how these observations were done. Okay, so good, Gaurav. I see one question about Julian and Jovian days.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall I answer that?
Yes.
Shall I answer that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, so you see, the time periods that we have, the kind of the calendar and the dates and all that that we have, they are slightly artificial constructs, but based on natural periodicities. Like, what are the periodicities we have? We have the Earth spin, that is one periodicity. We have the moon going around the Earth, that is one periodicity. We have the Earth going around the sun, this is roughly 1 year, moon going around the Earth, roughly 1 month, Earth spinning, roughly 1 day. But none of these periodicities are such numbers that they divide each other, actually. In the sense that if you want to divide the whole time that the moon is going around the Earth into equal parts of days, you will find there is a little bit of leftover. These numbers are what are called non-commensurate. The day, the month, and the year. The divisions are slightly non-commensurate. So we are looking at periodicities, the Earth day periodicity, and trying to put it in a larger periodicity of a month or of a year and so on. But where things don't exactly fit each other so well. So therefore, if you talk of, let us say, 26th February of 2020 and 13th March of 2021, what is the number of days between them? If you want to calculate, it's not so simple, because there are all these divisions of the months and all that, and all of those complexities are there. So Julian days are actually a way of measuring time from a specific point in time. And you just, from then onwards, you don't bother about which month, which day, which weekday, any of that. You simply say so many Julian days since that particular point of time. So this then gives you a uniform stream of time. And astronomers use that. Julian day, from a specific point of time onwards, so many Julian days. So that will be a nice way of measuring time rather than months and weeks and days and so on. Okay, so that is Julian day. The Jovian days would be like Jupiter spins in about maybe 9 hours is its day. In 9 hours, it does the full spin. So that's a Jovian day. All right.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Mr. Krishna Kumar queries, what is the way of navigation in southern hemisphere as there is no Polaris? Is there any South Pole star?
There is no exact South Pole star. There is a kind of Southern Cross, which is kind of lying around the South Pole. So there is no exact South Pole star. So you will have to probably, I mean, people, if they are going to use that, have to have an idea of a point in space with respect to the Southern Cross to use as a pole, idea of the pole. However, you know, if you are looking at the pole, even in positional astronomy, you are actually going to look at the pole. The angle that the pole makes is going to give you the latitude. Many of you are aware of it. However, as I was saying, if we come down to actual measurements, and which all of you should do, the simplest way of measuring the angle for pole is take maybe two pens and hold one pen along the horizon and the other pen to the pole star and measure this angle. This is what my brother, when he got me interested in astronomy from his college astronomy club. And when he went for an interview, he was asked and he said, take these two sticks and measure this. And well, the answer was satisfied because he got admission in IIM Ahmedabad. That is one way. That is the simplest way. However, how accurate can you measure it? So to go a little more accurate, you actually do that other thing which I said, make a small thread so that it hangs down perpendicular, so that exactly you will know the angle towards the horizon. Even so, with a simple instrument, the best you could do like if you do the celestial navigation kind of a thing, maybe within about 100 kilometers area on the surface of the earth, if you use simple handmade instruments. If you want to know your exact location, these measurements have to be made very, very exactly. And that is where instruments like the sextant, etc., come in, which are used in celestial navigation. All right. So Southern Pole Star, somebody is saying Epsilon Octantis. All right. There may be a faint star in that direction. However, I mean, it may not be such a very well-known object. There may be. By the way, even this pole star is going to change with precision. That is another very interesting thing. The Dhruv Tara, which we think of pole star, it's only, maybe a couple of 1,000 years back and a little more perhaps, when it became the pole star. If you go back to earlier mentions of it, actually it would be seen to move in the sky and so on. All right. Okay.
Thank you, Rekha ma'am. Actually, ma'am, there are a couple of questions which I have also received over my inbox. And you have partially answered the first part to it, because the question was precession known to the ancient astronomers? And over the discussion that you had done, you have partially answered that query. And the supplementary question to that, because I just would like to put both of them together so that you can answer them at length. There is a motion which is known as precession, in which you have talked about the top-like motion of the Earth. This is a query by Anirudh Ji, and he has told that on this entire, the entire period of 26,000 years, roughly, the Earth is expected to move like a top-like motion. But in that mean period of time, ideally speaking, pole star should return back again to the Polaris after 26,000 years, if we count from day zero now. But what is the guarantee that pole star will return back after the entire period of rotation? Because pole star also has got its own proper motion.
Yeah, very good question. See, the thing is that point in space, yes, it's going to come back in 26,000 years. And you see, but the proper motion time scales, 26,000 years seems like a huge amount to us. But when it concerns stars, and if we are looking at star evolution timescales, if we are thinking, okay, if the pole star is finishing its nuclear fuel and going out, if we are worried about that, those timescales are very, very much larger. So 26,000 years will not mean anything in terms of pole star evolution. But yes, proper motion may actually make more observable. I don't know what is the exact proper motion of pole star. So why don't you just look that up and try to figure out how much of a distance it's going to move from where it is now. And of course, from when it about 1,000 years back, it became the pole star. 26,000 years later, it's going to come back. What is its? So actually, it would be a good exercise for you to do that. And the first part, as you said, it was answered. So the couple of examples I gave, where in Satapatha Brahmana, there is a mention of Kritikas on the equator, and there is in the Vedanga Jyotisha, there is a mention of winter solstice at one of the solstices at Shravishta, actually shows precessional motion. So from that, we know that the time scale of one and the time scale of other are vastly different, because precession is actually seen in those two mentions. So that is one thing. But your point about the, by the way, pole star, you know, like we think of it as the Sthir Tara, right? But it is variable. It's a variable star. So its brightness varies. So even from apart from other things. But your point about proper motion is very nice. Make that calculation. It will be a nice small thing to do, and we can discuss it in the WhatsApp group later.
Ma'am, perhaps Rohini is, you can say, very much famous for its fast motion as a star. So, last query, there is one query by Mr. Abhishek. He wants to know, ma'am, you were talking and you had displayed about the different types of coordinate systems with the help of software display. Is there any scientific methodology in which we can convert one system coordinate to the other system like we do in mathematics?
Absolutely, absolutely. Without that, independent coordinate systems would not be of much use. You can. You will need to know, like when you are doing these conversions, you will need to know the time when you are observing and your location and so on. If you are making altitude azimuth measurements, where you are observing from, when you are observing, you combine that and you can convert it into right ascension declination measurements, or alternately into ecliptic latitude, longitude. Okay, I would like to show one thing. If I can find it on Google Images, if I can find it, I will show it to you. Because it's such a curiosity and not everybody is aware of it. What is it called? Let me see if I can find an image of it. And then I'll tell you why I'm looking for it. Yeah, there, I do have it. So let me do a screen share. Just give me 1 second. Okay, na? There it is. So though, forget all these other things, but this one. So let me just. This is the Kapala Yantra or Kapala Yantra. Arey, yaar, I've lost my internet. Am I still audible here?
Yes, ma'am. You are perfectly audible. And we are able to see the screen also.
Yeah, somehow I lost that image. It said not available. So that's what made me wonder. But you can see this one, right? You can see this small Kapala Yantra or Kapali Yantra, Jantar Mantar Jaipur. Can you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
And my pointer there. So that is a spherical instrument. And there are two such spherical bowl instruments in Jaipur. One of them actually has a crosswire in the center. The crosswire then will tell you that you are actually doing measurements. A spherical bowl instrument, actually you can do all coordinates in a spherical bowl instrument. But there is one spherical bowl instrument in Jaipur. Any of you go there, take a look at it. It doesn't have a crosswire. And it has all kinds of markings in it. Why? It's not an observing instrument at all. It's an instrument for converting coordinates. So you can actually use the Kapala Yantra to convert between the local and the ecliptic and the other coordinates. Of course, Indian coordinate system also has a peculiar mix of ecliptic and equinoxial coordinates. So there are something called the Dhruvaka and Vikshepa. But the Kapala Yantra does for us simple conversions between the coordinates, local and the equatorial and the ecliptic coordinate system. So yes, you can convert and it is very essential to do so.
Thank you, ma'am. And ma'am, this is a very last query which I have received just as we were toward the closing remarks. There is a student of class 11th and Mr. Akhilesh, and he wants to learn more about another coordinate system which actually we have not talked in detail regarding the right ascension and declination. So ma'am, he just wants to know that is how we can learn and what is the simplistic way to express explain the meaning of right ascension and declination.
Okay, so right ascension and declination, basically, I don't know if my video is visible. I'll just again use my bangles to talk about it. But whatever it is, in 2 minutes, I cannot give you a full feeling of comfort with it. You will, you look up maybe SMART or online, you'll have several resources to get a feel for what exactly these are. Qualitatively, I'm telling you, right ascension refers to angles along the equator, starting from the vernal equinox, eastwards you go, and these 360 degrees are divided into 24 hours. So right ascension usually is given to you in hours, minutes, and seconds for an object. The center is the center of the Earth, all right? So that is right ascension, and the declination is parallel, that is easier to understand. Perpendicular to the equator, so you go to the North Pole, 90 degree positive declination. You go to the South Pole, 90 degree negative declination. Equator, 0 degrees of declination. And if you are from Delhi, you can go and use the Mishra Yantra. It allows you to measure the declination of the sun very easily. Again, if I go to show that picture and all, it will delay. But see the north-south movement of the sun, Uttarayan, Dakshinayan, is happening because the declination of the sun is changing. From the equator, the angle between the sun and the equator, that is the declination. So it changes from -23.5 degrees to +23.5, goes through zero, and so on. So that is the declination of the sun, and the declination of other objects too is similarly the angle between the equator and those objects from the center of the Earth. Then, of course, using software and so on, you can explore what these declination, right ascension declination are for each of these objects. If you want to do your own measurement, the simplest would be to have a bowl-shaped measuring instrument. So, for instance, the Jayaprakash Yantra at the Jantar Mantar Observatory, is one instrument which actually allows you to measure right ascension and declination of an object. The Chakra Yantra, these are instruments which are there in some of the Jantar Mantar observatories. They allow you, but first you have to actually measure something called the hour angle and convert it to the right ascension and declination and so on. Come and join the WhatsApp group. We'll have more detailed discussions of it. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure, ma'am. And ma'am, perhaps on an ending note, I just would request you to kindly tell about a little bit about the project of Astronomy Code Camp also, because there are a lot of students who are listening to it. This is my humble request.
Yeah, so basically, you see, for having a good hands-on feel of astronomy, a little more quantitative, one is, of course, you try and do these measurements and instruments so that you can actually have some numbers in your hand and connect those numbers to what is out there in the sky. So that is one way. And the other is to actually have certain of these numbers, maybe through your measurements or maybe through somebody else's measurements. And once those numbers become larger and larger, to get some sense out of them. Even, for instance, for the Samantha challenge, a number of angles between Jupiter and Saturn were measured. So you have all those numbers and put them in tables. But instead of that, if you actually start making a graph out of it and doing some kind of analysis, errors and so on. So to do all of that, it is useful for you to know some kind of coding. And these days, I think the best probably to do all of this would be Python. Now, Python, using Python for doing something simple like that would be like taking a road roller and crunching a peanut. But still, the fact that you have the power of the road roller is good for you to know. So you start in small steps, like doing some simple graphs of this kind, small analysis related to data, I mean, from astronomical context. So it would be good to take that up. In fact, if you want to do anything serious in astronomy, you necessarily need to have those coding skills. So for beginners and for people associated with in kind of informal spaces like here in the planetarium we have. So we have been doing monthly code camps. So usually we do maybe 3 days. But looks like the March one is getting shifted to early October, early April. But we are having 3-day code camps almost every month. And come and join those to learn basics of Python coding and doing astronomical measurements in any context. Last month we did in the context of X-ray astronomy and so on. Probably we'll do some radio astronomy data also in the next one and so on. Or start with some very basic positional astronomy data to be looked at. A lot of the Jantar Mantar data that I have, it will do well to do actually some kind of analysis, basic positional astronomy. So come for the code camps too.
Thank you, ma'am. It has been a mesmerizing journey, which we can specify in a couple of words, that is the astronomical merry-go-round, which you have talked in terms of the quantifiable mathematics, as well as the display or the practical display of the different software analysis at the elementary level, which you have given as in the form of a beautiful insight. And special thanks to you for giving us your time, in spite of the fact that you were not well today. So now I hope that a lot of queries are there, but not to satisfy just for the sake of saying, but I shall surely mail you the queries that have been mailed by the students to me. And so that, and perhaps if they join together with you in the WhatsApp groups of Samantha Challenge, as well as the code camp, which I have just shared over the chat, so that they can really, really join and they can learn from the experiences and the practical activities of yours. So now over the virtual platform, I just would like to invite my co-host, Susatya Rekha ma'am, and special thanks to B. Srinivas sir for taking up the opening session. Rekha ma'am, kindly present the formal vote of thanks so that we can head up for the closure of the session. Thanks again, Ratnashri ma'am.
Thank you.
Rekha ma'am, kindly unmute yourself. You are muted right now.
If there is an interest at some stage, if you want me to do slower and more hands-on, that can be done at a later stage. Yes. Thanks.
Yes, Rekha ma'am, kindly.
Ma'am, it's a very wonderful session, madam. తెలుగులోకి వచ్చేద్దామండి. చాలా ఎక్కడెక్కడికో వేయించి వచ్చేసాము. కొద్దిసేపు చాలా సేపు కూడా స్టైల్లోకి తీసుకెళ్ళిపోయారు. చాలా మంది ఇందులో వాళ్ళు
ఆకాశ వీధిలో
విహరిస్తూ. థ్యాంక్ యూ మ్యామ్. We enjoyed a lot, and also we learned so much, madam. Mainly astro historical yantras, historical ancient yantras about it. Very nice, ma'am. At the same time, about astro project, what you said is so nice. We will definitely join our students, and also we are also participating in it, ma'am. Thank you so much for this wonderful session once again. Chala anandanga undi, chala baga undi, madam.
Normally chedam.
Actually, this is not completed in 1 week or okka varam lo ka chala rojul nunchi our amrutanshu was pay doing a lot of work about this session, madam. So I would like nice. Thanks to our Amrutanshu and also our Saptarishi team and Vijnana Bharati and everybody. My heartfelt gratitude to all the members, my team members. Thank you once again. Thank you, Amrutanshu, for giving this opportunity. Ma'am, definitely Telugu lo okasari malla kalugutamu
Telugu lo kuda chestam. Chestam definitely. I enjoyed very much. I'll be happy to do more.
Yes. Thank you, Amrita.
So with these words, I declare the formal closure of the session and wish all the participants all the luck and success for the upcoming astronomical endeavor after the vernal equinox, and wish you a very happy spring season after the gloomy COVID days of 2019 and 2020. And thank you. Thanks a lot, Ratnashree ma'am. Again, thanks again on behalf of Saptarishi family. Okay. Good night all.
Thank you.